Hello and welcome to J-Pod. This is a podcast on journalists and journalism. My name is Krishna Prasad and it's great to see you here. Largely because of the low road Indian news media has taken in the last couple of decades, and directly as a result of the COVID crisis in the last few weeks, it looks like we will have to press the reset button once again. A hard reset, actually, this time. Frankly, no one knows what's in store in the immediate future, but a couple of possibilities are very easy to guess. One, as news organizations slash jobs and salaries to balance the books and to keep enterprises afloat, India's already bare newsrooms will get further hollowed out, chipping away at the core functions of journalism. There will be fewer foreign correspondents, fewer specialists, and fewer older heads as companies sacrifice institutional memory and seek younger people with a lower cost to company whose skills can be utilized across platforms. Expertise will be outsourced even more than ever before. And after 2 months of working from home, bosses will elevate telephone reporting, I would think, into a virtue to save money on travel and other expenses. This is not rocket science, really, just plain common sense. The second possibility that one can discern at this moment is that the distinction between serious and frivolous journalism, between the important and the inane, will diminish even further. In the quest for numbers, in the chase for the lowest common denominator, Indian news media had to make several key sacrifices. Now, after COVID, with digital players snapping at their heels, with advertising getting tighter, with consolidation on the cards, it looks like news organizations will have to find newer ways of milking the old cow. The line between news and advertisement, which is barely visible in many organizations today, will reach the point of virtually vanishing. And because consumers have grown used in the last few weeks to receiving news digitally, where the distinction is nearly quite absent, the lockdown will provide the further rationale for shorter, snappier, tactile content, and original journalism such as we know it will take a backseat, with rehashing and repackaging becoming the norm. And the end result of all this is that we will most likely be looking at a very weakened news media system, beholden to the government of the day for sustenance and survival. And this will have deep and long-term implications for Indian democracy. Well, that's really what I think. And on this episode of J-Pod, I'm joined by a man who actually knows much better, a man who has an enviable 360-degree resume, Shashi Kumar. Old-timers will remember Shashi as the suave, dignified face of Doordarshan with a voice to match. But he has a lot more than that. He's been a foreign correspondent of The Hindu in the Gulf. He left Press Trust of India Television to set up India's first private news channel, Asianet News. He has directed a Hindi movie and done roles in Malayalam films. And he has been the chairman of the foundation which runs the Asian College of Journalism in Chennai. And as if all that weren't enough, Shashi Kumar set up a portal called AsiaWill last year in multiple languages to explore what the digital future holds. In other words, he's seen the print, television, digital and movie worlds and from different sides of the fence. In J-Pod today, Shashi argues that in the post-COVID world, the time may well have come to stop looking at news media as the holy cow. Good morning, Shashi.
Great to talk to you. Morning.
Hi, how are you doing?
Well as one can be in the circumstances.
Which is what? It doesn't say very much. All of us are cooped up at home.
Yeah, paradoxically, I find I'm doing more work now than I was before this health crisis hit us, before COVID-19 hit us. Yeah. Before I know it, it's evening and it's the next day is, you know, around the corner. So I don't know whether this is imagination or it's real, but there's a sense of time moving very fast and at a frenetic pace, and a lot of work being done. And a lot of work also, work at home and so on being done, you know, things you've never done before. So it's good. It's a chastening experience.
Well, I mean, I think you saw yesterday that Twitter's chief, Jack Dorsey,
yes,
has told his staff that they can stay at home forever. You know, they need not come to work. Only if required, they can come. But he's very comfortable with people staying at home and working. And I also saw Vineet Jain of the Times of India early on actually talk about the virtues of working from home. Yes. And I suppose these are the kinds of, you know, what you might call paradigm shifts, which are kind of likely to happen, right?
Yeah, it is true in the context of, you know, we have this new startup called AsiaVille in four languages, English, Hindi, Tamil, Malayalam. And we noticed that over the last 2 months, the volume, productivity in terms of volume and quality of work as well, has actually increased sharply. Of course, the consumption has also increased sharply because people are coming on to digital platforms now, consuming digital media in a bigger manner. But the volume, the work by, so they're all working from home, all the, you know, the reporters and the editors. And I think it's particularly in a place like Delhi, you know, you're saving travel time. And if you're doing a tech story, it really doesn't make a difference whether you're coming to the office and doing it or at home. Well, it's too early to say that in the long run, whether you need the ambience of an office to compare notes, to you know, to toss ideas, to refine ideas for brainstorming and so on. But these two can be done online, I guess. So right now, it looks like not a bad deal, actually, to be working online.
You know, but I mean, you know, if you remember, the old thing about journalism was all about going to the ground, smelling the grass, smelling the air, talking to people. You know, what digital journalism did in the middle was essentially to remove that process. You know, it became all about packaging and rehashing and so on because of you know, great websites in the West. But surely we can't be elevating this situation to that extent where we completely show disdain towards gumshoe reporting. Surely we need to go down. I mean, even now as we speak, the stellar work that is standing out, even among mainstream players, are people who have actually gone down to the ground, like Bakhadat, for example. You know, so whilst this might be cost effective, this might be more productive, the truth is that great journalism is not going to come just by, you know, people talking on the phone like we are. You know, people do need to go to the ground, you know, dig deep, you know, etc.
Absolutely. I mean, there's no doubt about that. It depends on the kind of journalism one is involved in. There's no substitute for, I mean, being there on the ground and, you know, looking at what's happening. And the context that you mentioned of, you know, when you have a huge floating population now of people who have been uprooted from where they were working and not reached their homes. And, you know, if you want to know anything about what's happening there, really, except the statistics, you need to be there to get a sense of the human dimension of that, you know, this unfolding tragedy. And you're right, sir, some journalists have done, you know, exemplary work there. And the journalism that stands out right now is that. It's the first person kind of account, you know. The journalism at one remove can be done from anywhere, whether from the office or from home, I guess.
You know, I've been, you know, obviously I'm sure I'm not just alone in this, but I'm sick and tired of hearing this phrase, new normal. I'm sure it's been coming out of your ears too. You know, it's being used to suggest something very deep, but actually it's being used so loosely that it really means nothing at the end of the day. But for someone like you, you know, Shashi, to get deep down into this, for someone like you who's done print and television and digital journalism and who has set up and run businesses and nonprofits, what to you looks like the new normal? I mean, what would you be comfortable with going forward?
Paradoxically, I think, you know, the situation is, you know, disruption is a term that you associated with new media, for instance, you know, with digital media. Now, but actually what has happened is there's been a continuity in terms of digital media. The disruption has taken place in our actual lives, physical lives, in terms of social distancing, in terms of not being going out and being able to interact socially and so on. But if you look at the way the media has gone on, it's actually been a continuity, except for, you know, as you say, ground reporting, you know, makes it more difficult. But people are still out there reporting. But the continuity is actually in the realm that you thought will be disrupted. And the disruption is actually in the physical life that you thought will not will have continuity. So this is one of the paradoxes, I think, of the space that we are passing through. And so when you talk about the new normal, there is, what is the new normal in terms of the media? I don't think there is going to be a new normal in that sense. A new normal, I think, when you say you associate it with the fact that you can't shake hands probably or hug people to express your, you know, warmth or affection, and that there'll be social distancing for some time. There'll be suspicion about virus in the air wherever you are and stuff like that. And of course, adjusting to the straitened economic circumstances that we'll be coming into when we have this virus totally behind us. But other than that, in terms of the media, I see more, a spurt in continuity, if you like, a more intensified continuity of the media. It's become more viciously digital, if you like, or more, strongly digital, intensely digital. And we are going to be, we are connected far more than before, because I think we're probably consuming media far more than before. I saw a report by the, by an agency which said that we are now consuming some 24 hours of media a week, which is about three and a half hours a day average, which is quite fascinating. So I think this is the kind of paradox that we are going through now. And in terms of the media, I see a intensification of the engagement of the media. There's no disruption, but in our actual lives, in the physical world that we live in, we are moving away from one another. We're wary of one another. And that may take some time to disappear or, be less worried about.
No, but when you say, when you quote that figure saying that people are consuming more media per week, surely that's a somewhat of a one-sided thing, right? I mean, we don't know what media this is. We don't know whether this is movies or whether this is news or TV shows, or just games. I mean, people are just, extrapolating a random number, something that suits them. For example, I saw the Times of India put out a front page story when they were facing a huge distribution crisis, saying that people were spending more time reading the newspaper. I mean, how do you believe that? Similarly, the social media thing, or even, I think I saw something like a threefold increase or something. I mean, I'm seeing lots of numbers. But we need to make a distinction between media per se and news media, which I think you and I are more interested in, surely, news media. So therefore, what is the change you see? There are people, consuming more news media, or are they just consuming more media?
I have no real analysis on that, but I have a slightly different take on this. I think the virtue of enclosing news media as a holy cow is, I think, not likely to pass muster, given the way it's being technologically determined. Because a lot of social media is news media, in my view. Blogs, your blogs, for instance, are they news media or social media? I would argue that they are both. They are you straddle the two worlds. And there's a lot of segueing from the news media proper to the social media. I'm not talking about the pure gossip, the pure hates, the poison, the biases, the prejudices, the echo chambers, those filter bubbles and so on. Those are obviously identifiable as something which is pure social behavioral, behavior in the social media, space or ecology. But this is one of the paradigm shifts I'm wondering that we may be going through in this phase, is our definition of news media is going to get more diffused. The framework is getting more diffused. And we are actually looking at information and knowledge which makes a difference to our lives, which provides context, which provides meaning to what's happening around us. And if that is news, so be it. If that is information, so be it. If that's entertainment, so be it. I think these differences are something we may want to keep strongly in place. But I'm not so sure it's necessary anymore. I wouldn't have thought I'd say this about 5 years back, but now I'm beginning to see, because I find younger people, for instance, they are far more informed in an eclectic sense. There's a far more eclectic approach to information and knowledge, and news is a subset of that. Is the way I'd like to look at it.
No, that is true. I mean, I mean, as someone who also produces this kind of stuff, I can't quibble with what you say. But what I mean to say is, surely, this is the masala. This is the topping of
what should be the very strong base, you know.
Yeah.
So we can't make, you know, memes and listicles and stuff like that, which we sit in our shorts and, you know, stitch up. I don't think that can become the most important thing in the consumption habits of a consumer, right?
Yeah. Yes, and no, perhaps. See, I mean, Pulitzer Prize is named after Joseph Pulitzer, who was the yellow journalist par excellence of his times.
Correct.
Right?
So,
but why do we commemorate the man? Why do we remember him? Of course, he put money into the Institute of the Prize. And if you look at some of the journalism that we've characterized as, you know, I mean, in the traditional sense, in the legacy media sense, as yellow or, you know, as being sensationalist or being over the top, some of them are that, but some of them actually lead to bigger, you know, disclosures, bigger investigations, bigger exposés and so on. So I've always had this doubt about whether we are, whether it's not a middle class puritanical squeamishness that defines news the way some of us, you know, in our generation have looked at it or defined it, and whether one of the, shall we say, useful functions of social media, you know, engaging this space, you know, swamping this space, has been to dilute that straitjacketed, blinkered idea of news as this cast in black and white as this. So I think that it's become far more amorphous. It's mutating like this virus. And I think the idea of what is the news ecology or the ecology, the media, news media ecology, I think is changing a lot. For instance, Krishna Prasad, if I might just elaborate on this, in the late 90s and in the turn of the century, you had this spate of acquisitions and mergers where non-news entities took over very professional news entities, you know, like say ABC, NBC in the United States, were taken over by say Disney at least was entertainment. Say an entity like General Electric takes over, you know, a news entity, and they become a small subset of the big empire, you know, and so a big corporate entity. And then I think this whole division, this whole tension between media and news took place, you know.
Yeah.
But now I think again, we need to talk in terms of media rather than news, because news has become a subset of the media itself. And you cannot, I think, isolate news and see it as a in an artificial showcased kind of manner, is my sense.
No, I'm happy you say these things, because it's good to hear these contrarian voices. So therefore, when you bring up the name of Joseph Pulitzer, the obvious comparison also is Alfred Nobel, because Nobel made dynamite, and basically he was aghast to see how people covered his fictional death, you know. Yes. So which is why he put in money, and therefore the Nobel Prize is now looked at so, you know, benignly. So therefore that's fine. But of course, this point that media or news media is a subset of the larger media is a contentious one, in the sense that I saw a conversation between Ronnie Screwvala and Uday Shankar of Star Disney. And Ronnie Screwvala was making the point that even sports is part of media. You know, so therefore, if you go down that path, then there's no end to it. You know? So there, I mean, sports journalism may be media, you know, to me.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Sports, pure play sports, as in watching sports, can't be media to me. I mean, beyond just a spectacle.
Well, I think... Well, sports is journalism in such a big way. Even the newspapers, you know, I mean, my son reads a newspaper from the sports page, and I don't know whether he reaches the front page at all. So, I mean, so there's a generation which reads the newspaper from backside, you know, forward. He flips the paper over and starts with the sports page. So that's news. That's journalism, I think, in a sense. I mean, when it comes to newspaper, of course, one watches the huge success of IPL and so on. It's entertainment, but it's sports. So what is it? I mean, that's the point. You know, this is what the discussion is. I think is that news? Is that entertainment? Is that not? So I think it's, and also, you know, today if you look at it, the biggest news platform is Google or Facebook. I mean, in that sense, you know, they pretend to be technology platforms, but we know that they are actually media platforms. And as we speak, as you know, now countries are saying Google should be sharing its revenues with them, you know, when they're cannibalizing the news generation, you know, entities. In Australia, it's become very strident. I believe in some parts of Europe too, they're picking it up. And maybe after COVID, that will be one big demand. In India, for instance, it's not a coincidence that at this time, when we think the economy is in doldrums and we don't know how deep the pit we are going to be staring at when we come out of this, Facebook buys into Reliance, about 10% of Reliance for some $5.5 billion. And there are others who are also following suit, including a private equity investment in America, Saudi investment, and so on. And so you know the news that's happening.
Yeah.
So there are these super competitors in the so-called new media space. And that media space includes a lot of news willy-nilly. When you're talking about Google as a platform, you have to accept that it contains all of the news that we're talking about. And when Reliance Jio moves into that into this kind of reach, it's going to be the biggest media entity probably in the country in some sense. And will it be only a purveyor? Will it be only a network? Will it only be distributing? I think really, in one sense, the medium being the message, as McLuhan said, is acquiring a new significance, when you find this whole transition taking place. So you have media and media and media. You have the super competitors like the Googles, the Facebook, Reliance in our context. Then you have, the legacy media, if you like, the big names, the big banner names in print and or in television. And then you have the startups, the standalone media, and then you have social media. And all these are, I think, intermingled, and it's difficult to actually separate one and say that this is the purer form of journalism, is my view.
No, that is a fair point. But, this is also a point which is music to the ears of many of these people who want us to get confused between what is real and what is fake, what is news and not news. I think this suits these people, so it suits Google and Facebook to confuse us about whether they are media players or advertising platforms or content platforms. So this is a useful confusion for most of these people. But of course, your core point about, that there is nothing holy about what we are doing is not a new point in my view, because generally speaking, you spoke of Pulitzer, but most people believe, especially in America, the academics believe that journalism is actually reverting to its roots. Journalism was a fun thing. Journalism was a really exciting, it was not so very sanctimonious in the long time past. It's only in the post-Watergate period that it became so serious, this whole thing of keeping news and editorial separate, of being staid and sober, all that picked on. So in a sense, media, as you are putting it, is reverting to its, old form, which is entertaining, which is exciting, which is titillating, which is, a lot of masala, which also keeps a larger mass of people involved.
Yeah. Yes, partly that, but partly also because even if you look at the strict confines of the news media, where would you put certain television channels, for instance? I don't want to mention name. Whom I think in my mind, we would hesitate to call it journalism, but it's media, right? They are probably as good or worse than social media in terms of spewing poison and hate and creating a division in society and othering and minority bashing and all of that you see.
Yeah.
The dominant media, which is, the in-your-face media of television in India, is unfortunately that for a good part. So do I want to claim that as journalism? How does it make a difference to journalism? So it's a non-issue for me. That whole debate becomes a non-issue, because even in your own fraternity, the birds of the same feather are looking terrible. That's the problem with trying to eke out a particularly, shall we say, professional idea of journalism from this welter of confusion that we have in the media now.
You were asking, how do we categorize these channels which are doing what they're doing?
I
can tell you that one of the people whose names I took up just a little while earlier once told me that we should classify them under non-fiction general entertainment. So that's one way of looking at it, because that's a confusion which is always going to be there. But let's stretch this point a little forward, because you are a thinker of this whole business. when we confuse media and news media or sports media with media or any other media, and you know, we put it all under this in this one single basket, the problem we have, of course, is the thing which Neil Postman brought up in 1976. He called this amusing ourselves to death, you know, which is basically that, as opposed to what Orwell spoke of in 1984, of a big brother controlling us and controlling our thoughts and actions. Neil Postman was coming from the Aldous Huxley point of view, which is that as opposed to a very limited supply, we give you so much oversupply, you don't know the difference between this and that. So you don't know the difference between what is important and not important. So therefore, when we speak or try to speak of this distinction between news media and other media, I think the point you are trying to really make is, what is more important to democracy and to citizens? What is more vital in our functioning, in our daily lives? So I think that distinction, pardon my saying, needs to be there. I mean, if we get so confused that we don't know whether a WhatsApp meme is the same, has got the same value as a Hindu editorial, then we really have a problem.
Yeah, no, I certainly think the Hindu editorial has greater value than WhatsApp. But I don't think I should scorn at those who think having a healthy WhatsApp debate is more important than reading an editorial in The Hindu. So it's a matter of, I think that is the essence of democracy, that kind of diversity. You know, democracy means, I mean, if you say democracy in one breath, I agree, you must be able to say a free media in the next breath. Otherwise, that democracy is a sham. But at the same time, it should be a freewheeling democracy, you know, not just a free democracy, freewheeling democracy. You must be able, I mean, there must be license, there must be, you know, and if there's any consequence, it must come because of the law of the land, and not because of a lynch mob mentality, not because some puritanical thoughts, people thinking things, say this is beyond the, you know, the framework of good social discourse or journalistic discourse. So I think, in the age of social media, that's become an imperative. The anarchy, the dystopia out there, the iconoclasm out there, the heterodoxy out there is going to be far more exciting and far more, shall we say, tempting and far more valuable, in my view, in many ways, than a long habit. Thomas Paine famously said, a long habit of thinking something wrong gives it a superficial, you know, appearance of being right. You know, so this kind of thing, I think perhaps we need to reconsider the entire valorization of what we call the news media. After all, it's a 400, 500-year-old activity, journalism, from 17th century onwards. So maybe it's come to a juncture, it's at a watershed moment or a defining moment where it is going through a churn, and you are seeing a more democratized, a more awakening, a more realization of the public sphere. I think the public sphere and public interest is paramount. And whatever is befitting that, I think, is what I think, in my view, should be privileged, you know, for journalists, for media practitioners.
Well, my friends at the Times of India, at least former friends at the Times of India, Ravid Dhariwal in particular and Rohit Kansal will be very happy to hear what you're saying, because these are the points they have made forever. When they have tried to basically sell the newspaper like a soap or a shampoo, you know. So they have always argued that, you know, they have always argued on this kind of ambiguity between news and non-news. In fact, I remember getting into a big tiff because one of the newspapers in Bangalore once did a lead story on 6 or 12 puppies kind of getting drowned in one of the localities. And I was really so angry that this had happened, that, you know, the drowning of puppies was lead story in the newspaper. And Mr. Dhariwal actually said, why not? You know? So therefore, that's my point, which is, if you think the drowning of 6 puppies or 12 puppies is the lead story in the Times of India in Bangalore, then you really have a problem, because that underlines the issues you're talking about, which is the confusion. Theoretically, more people are interested in the 6 puppies, surely, but that can't be the main thing, right?
No, but that's because we're imagining the Times of India is the world of the media. Times of India is not that pervasive. The English language media itself is not that pervasive, right? So it is, let us admit it, what is the preoccupation of the English language media? It is a middle class. It is the sensibilities of the middle class. How much of ruralness, how much of, you know, what's happening there is reflected in this media. Fact that it is totally and grossly underrepresented and unrepresentative. So it's not as if, you know, we're taking on the entire universe of the media. What should concern somebody in a village, somebody in a township, is not as well reflected in the media as what's concerning somebody living in a metropolis, you know, because the tastes, the sensibilities of these are what privilege them. Sainath recently raised this important point that 18 people died on a railway track. How many newspapers listed the names and identities of these 18 people?
Absolutely.
Imagine if there were two people in an air crash who died. You'd know all about their entire biodata, right? So
yes.
that is the same English language media which is giving you this kind of news, this kind of warped, you know, biased news. So I think we shouldn't. So if Times of India is talking about puppies, that is their concern. Their constituency wants to learn about puppies. The Hindu will talk about, you know, larger issues, the grave issues perhaps in the public sphere. The Indian Express may do something else, and another newspaper may do something else. So that is the whole. So one has to look at the media as a composition of a variety of treatments, a variety of demographics, a variety of taste patterns, and it's a sum total of that makes for a healthy democracy. I don't think one should privilege one over the other too much, because then I think we are living privileged lives, perhaps. Others are living less privileged lives. Their concerns may be different, and their their thoughts may be different. So I'm really confused about this, honestly. I'm not putting out an argument for the sake of argument, but especially when media moved multimedia, right? Now,
yeah.
You know, for a long time, you had the primacy of the written word. The written word was, authoritative media, credibility, newspaper of record, that kind of stuff. But now you moved into digital technology where you can read, you can hear, you can see a combination of that. You can see a video embedded in an article. And so all your human faculties are consuming, your human and sensorium is the entire media sensorium itself. There's a kind of synergy there. And therefore, you'll find everything there. So for us to say, to spin off what is valid media in this is, I think, a risky proposition now.
Yeah, surely I like the confusion. I think we need confusion rather than too much clarity, frankly.
Yeah.
And we'll be better off with that. But the problem with what we're discussing is that if we confuse citizens with consumers, which is what many newspapers do, which is what many websites do, which is what many TV channels do, then this essential confusion arises, because there can't be, in my mind, there can't be any confusion about the value of those 18 lives which are lost on a railway track. But
yeah.
You are not serving it up because your consumers don't want it, because your consumer is urban, English-speaking,
right.
Upper class or upper middle class, so he's maybe not interested. So therefore, if you look at your reader or a viewer as a consumer, then this thing really pops up. On the other hand, if you look at them as citizens, as constituents just like you in a democracy, then it's far more clear in my mind.
Precisely. So what has happened is, since 1991, with the age of liberalization and globalization, the market model of the media has become so strong. The market model of the media has become overwhelmingly strong. So much so that you find, it's not a coincidence that it's after that we said Manmohan Singh was the best CEO, prime minister of the country. This whole convergence of the business market model and the political model, that happened in the media too. Editors, including yourself, who were chief editors of well-known, prestigious media magazines, periodicals or newspapers in this country, were at some point, I think your mandate was not just to look after fine journalism, but also look after revenues. So this combination of the marketing role and the editorial role, because the owners, whoever they were, they said, fine, you have all the independence you want, but you also make sure that the financial bottom lines are healthy and you run a paper as independently as you want. So the market model becomes inevitable in that kind of context. And therefore, you have to serve up things that will fetch you the advertising revenue. And therefore, the advertising revenue will depend on those who have the purchasing power. And so this process becomes almost inbuilt into the whole methodology of the media then, right? Into the functioning of the media. And that's why it narrows down to this. That's why it becomes so narrowcast in that sense. Otherwise, one would be reporting, in all the media, 70% of the reportage must be about rural India, because 70% of the people live in rural India. Why is that not so?
Yeah.
It's because of this, because the market model has become far more acute today. Of course, media was always a business. It is a capitalist enterprise. It must make profit. In fact, if a media doesn't make profit, it won't have the guts to stand up to power, to speak truth to power, and so on, as they say. But when profiteering and profit maximization becomes a model, as I suspect has become a model for the media now, of course, now they are in the doldrums because they're bigger, the big media too. But that became the model for quite, they had a strong, a long run of that kind of model. And that's where I think the entire identity of the media took the beating that it did.
You know, this when someone listens to our conversation, you know, do you think he or she will get the feeling that India has kind of missed the beat, frankly? You know, because do you think this is the conversation they are having, let's say, in the New York Times as we speak? Is this confusion there in the New York Times to just put one newspaper on the table?
I think so, because the New York Times would be an even more exclusive newspaper. I don't think it's by, you know, it's because of its vast pervasive reach that it is influential and it is important and so on. But I would hesitate to call the New York Times a mass media, you know. And because also it's successfully moving incrementally behind a paywall and, you know, getting subscription revenues like FT and so on and so forth. So I don't even know if there are examples of mass media anymore other than state-run medias. In India, for instance, Doordarshan could be a mass media. But otherwise, you have such a fragmented thing that in all the neighborhood newspapers, all the newspapers in the various states in the United States have folded up because they became unviable. So it's only the ones which can straddle a vast expanse, you know, like the New York Times or the Washington Post and so on, or the Times in England and so on, you know, which continue to have that kind of prestige internationally or even nationally. In India also, you find some of those. That's the way it's going, and the more grand you become, the rich you. Of course, McChesney said that wonderfully. He said, "Rich media, poor democracy." Direct correlation: richer the media, the poorer the democracy. But I think you can also say that when scale, you know, the media has become big like that, it also it doesn't necessarily mean it's reaching out to more people. It means it's reaching out to the right kind of sliver of people, which fetches the wherewithal, the valuable dollars or rupees. To run a profitable business.
No, actually, where I'm coming from is not where you are approaching it. You know, I'm not saying this at all. I'm saying that, you know, the New York Times is in the same boat as we are, or all of us are in the same storm as everybody else. Okay, but the point I'm trying to make is that, is the New York Times, let's say, as confused as, say, the Hindu or the Times or Deccan Herald or Telegraph about what is more important at this point? You're saying that because of this confusion between media and mass media and sports and this and that, we need to be necessarily confused because that's what it is. But is the New York Times confused? You know, I'm saying that, on the contrary, that despite the fact that New York Times serves up such serious stuff, such deep dives, such great investigations, such well thought of editorials and so on and so forth, I'm not saying they're flawless, but the point I'm trying to make is that there does not seem to be great confusion in the minds of good news organizations which know what comes first.
Yes, and also you can't abandon your identity, you know, suddenly. Even if the New York Times were tempted to dive into this social media welter, you know, and make more money, they can't do it because they don't have the skill sets to do that. I mean, you are trained to handle a kind of journalism of decorum, of record, of importance, of investigation, of verification, and that's what they do very well. And therefore, that has a particular value. There are other kinds of media which have different kinds of value. As I said, it depends on the constituency that you're appealing to. You know, New York Times, I'm only trying to suggest, therefore, is not appealing to a universal constituency. It is there as a great exemplar of, you know, good journalism, continuing to be a good journalism. But the fact of the matter is it have an agenda building function now? Not as much as before, because President Trump doesn't read the New York Times. I mean, I don't think he reads to begin with. He's speaking over all the media, you know, he's leapfrogging the media and talking to a particular constituency that is interested in. Our own Prime Minister does that in India. I mean, he's not given a press conference for all you know. He may be reading the Hindu, he may not be reading the Hindu. What is Hindu's agenda building and agenda shaping, influence today? Not as powerful as it was in a liberal, in a more responsive liberal kind of regime, political, regime. So So, but we continue to value the Hindu. We continue to value the editorials and so on and so forth. There's no doubt about that. The opinions, and even the Times of India, to be fair, they do this and they do that as well. They run a very efficient newspaper as well, you know. So I think it takes all of this together, and it's no longer a simple world of great journalism and not so great journalism. I think it's differences of kinds of journalisms and the news media out there.
Yeah, no, so I don't disagree with that. I mean, I think the point where I disagree with is this, that these great organizations like the New York Times or the BBC or the Guardian, you know, what they have succeeded in doing is that while they continue to do what they were doing very well, they have added these bells and whistles. You know, for example, you spoke of New York Times and social media. Actually, they are very strong on social media. You know, believe it or not, one of the most beautiful web series I saw last year was built on a New York Times column called Modern Love. You know, so eight great love stories. Who would expect that from the New York Times? Right. So what I'm saying is that these great organizations have continued to value good journalism. They are not confused about what journalism is. But at the same time, they do the new things and do it very well. Where we are not doing that is that we have abandoned virtually almost everything in our process of seeking numbers and seeking advertising and so on and so forth. So that's my basic small little quibble. But, you know, we can keep going on and on, Sashi, as we swing into the last few minutes. You know, let me just, ask you, because you've been a very fine critic and observer of the media landscape for so long for Frontline Magazine. What are the two or three big changes you think you've seen since January? Globally and in India, you know, in terms of news production and also in terms of news consumption, what are the two or three things you think you remember?
Well, I think the opinion and, you know, considered opinion and editorial has become the mainstay of the newspaper, because otherwise pure information is available aplenty everywhere. Of course, you still need filters of verification. So I think the opinion and you read a newspaper now to know a viewpoint, you know, to have somebody arguing a point of view, or the newspaper's own considered view on something, which is expressed in the editorial pages and so on. I think the other big takeaway is as we mentioned earlier, the advent of multimedia, so that, you know, you're more image friendly and audio friendly and video friendly, particularly on your website. It's moving at least in that direction. I think newspaper organizations, you know, place a lot of emphasis now on multimedia skilling and multitasking journalists who have a bit of all of these capabilities. Not just a pure fine writer. I think on the flip side, I think the value of a good editor, a good desk, you know, it's collapsing. It's collapsing. You know, language. Yeah. You know, copy editing is, you know, I mean, people don't think it's so important anymore, unfortunately. And I personally feel it's a terrible thing, because language, you know, the fineness of language is taken a backseat. So these are some of the striking, you know, differences that I find. And of course, we are told now that the future will be one of a dispersed newsroom of a news organization where people will be working in different places and yet contributing to the making up of a page, whether it's a physical newsprint page or a page on a digital tablet or whatever it is. So that's the way it's going, I think.
You know, not just in India, but in several countries, you tend to notice that leaders have used this pandemic and the crisis and the lockdown to tighten their grip on information flow. What do you think has happened in India? You know, what is your understanding, you know, looking at this, what I think is very soft coverage? What do you think is the state of media freedom in India just now, especially post January, February? Is it higher than what it was, or lower, or what do you think has happened?
Oh, it's lower. There's no doubt about that. I think the media is either intimidated itself or being intimidated strongly. We know that in the World Press Freedom Index, you know, it's already slipped 3 or 4 ranks, come to 142nd out of 180 countries now, from 138. But more importantly, I think one of the, you know, early when this COVID-19 break, you know, happened, broke, and One of the things we heard in the beginning was the government putting out an insinuation that these are very important, you know, these times of emergency and sensitive times, the media must tail the government viewpoint. I mean, they didn't say in as many words, but they were saying, you know, this is a nation-building exercise. We should all stand together to fight. In other words, any dissonant voice, any contradictory voice would be seen as anti-national, as has been the practice now for some time. Mm-hmm. So that suggestion was already put there. And we also know that some of the media, unfortunately, as I said, we have a strong fifth column in the Fourth Estate, you know, who actually play, you know, play the role of the propaganda arm of the government, or even better, the cat's paw of the government, swiping at anyone who looks even suspiciously at the government or those in power. So that media has become very active and, you know, proactive. So they're neutralizing the media, which is critical. And there was a suggestion that this is not the time for investigative journalism or to be critical of the government. You must set all that aside and just resort to what I would call handout journalism. You know, the government will say, put this out, you put this out. If you're a television, you read it. If you're a newspaper, you write it. That kind of stuff. So this handout journalism has become a norm. But I would think that this is the time for the media to be that much more vigilant and that much more investigative. Let's not forget that Amartya Sen's, analysis of China belongs to an emergency situation like this, when there was a huge famine in China, and because, of course, there was no free media, it was not being reported, and even the higher echelons of the Communist Party didn't know that people in their millions were dying, you know, out there, because the apparatchik at the lowest level would not dare report to his boss, to the bureaucracy up, that in his area, in his village, so many comrades or so many, people have died. So, lack of a free media. So the function of a free media as an early, you know, setting, you know, an early alarm bell function of the new media, of the free media, is that much more important here. And I think, as you said, the media has failed partly because we have not looked at issues of how, you know, it's still very obtuse how this government at the center is handling this COVID-19. Mm. Now, I think Kerala is a brilliant exception to that. You know transparently what they're doing. You know, whether it's good or bad, you know, every measure that's taking place, apart from press, you know, conferences, you know, it's also transparent. And including the sprinkler, you know, debate that's come up and, you know, about identities being disclosed. But all that is transparent. Whereas in the center, we don't know, except, you know, these the prime minister going live, but not talking anything about livelihoods. You know, so this kind of, and the media has not questioned it as stridently, as seriously as it should have.
And that is because of what reason, you think?
That is a lack, I think, the declining importance of independence, autonomy, we need more heterodoxy, you need more, you know, questioning media, challenging media. That's why I welcome that kind of thing. It's far more difficult for the government to tame an anarchic media situation, I think, than if they had to tackle only five big newspapers and the rest will tail the line, you know, toe the line. So you find small journalists being attacked. You know, as we speak, there's somebody in UP who's in trouble there, you know, so, yeah. And many others were not reported, perhaps, you know, that we don't know about. So, and look at for instance, in the UK, there was this wonderful article, I think, in the Sunday Times in March 5th or 6th, if I'm not mistaken, which spoke about how Boris Johnson sleepwalked the UK into disaster. If I remember right, that was the title of that investigative piece. So they are actually, you know, holding people to account, holding people in power, those who are responsible, to account. Here we are trying to, you know, rattle our, you know, toys or beach plates from our balconies and endorse what's going on. You know, so this handout journalism mentality, I think, has taken its toll, you know, in terms of the media freedom landscape.
No, of course, the media has been constantly and continuously tamed since 2014. So it's not a surprise that we have adopted this lapdog pose. But do you think this approach of the media at this critical time has been facilitated by by those few meetings that the Prime Minister had with media owners of both print and electronic media just before he announced the lockdown? Do you think all those... You know, I mean, Mr. Modi has not had a press conference in 6 years. He's not met any quality journalist who can ask him a proper question in 6 years. Yet he chose to meet the owners of TV stations and newspapers before the lockdown was announced. Do you think this current posture of the media is a direct result of that?
Maybe. I haven't really applied my mind to that. And you maybe actually have better insights on that. But when I spoke to an editor that I know well, who was a former chief editor of a newspaper, who didn't himself go, but somebody went from his newspaper, he said that, yes, the conversation was actually kind of a weak effort at consensus building of, you know, to stand with the government's measures at this point of time and so on. I think proprietors or editors or publishers should normally go and attend a meeting like that and then run the newspaper or the channel precisely the way they want to. But my worry, Krishna Prasad, is that Modi might have done that, but I don't think he has shown that he cares too much. Because he's leapfrogging the media. His engagement with the media is with the social media. It's through Man Ki Baat, you know, directly to his constituency, through his tweets. As you say, he's not given a single press conference. So, and if somebody says something critical about him, he already has those fifth column, you know, elements ready in the media. Who will take them on? So this is the danger of the situation, that the media is not, there is no solidarity in the media. The media is not just fragmented, it's also divided. And there is, the media is so ideologically divided, ideologically in the sense that, you know, pro the ruling party or against the party, this party and so on. But there should be at the bottom of that a sense of solidarity in terms of the freedom of the press. That I find lacking here, you know, and I think that that's a big difference, perhaps in India and you know, democracies like the USA or the UK. When push comes to shove, the media, you know, they come together and they resist any attempt to cow them down beyond a point.
You know, Shashi, the last couple of questions, it's become a kind of a cliche. You know, I've done a fair few of these podcasts in the last few weeks, but it's become a bit of a cliche to keep hearing that trust in the news media or trust in credible journalism has actually grown in these last few weeks. And this despite newspapers not being delivered, this despite newspapers having shrunk hugely in size, you know, and despite people spending more and more time online and on social media. You seem to hear this cliche that trust in the media has grown and so on. What do you think? Do you think trust has really grown in these last few weeks? Or is journalism really become incidental, you know, as we started off discussing, in people's lives? You know, they are doing a lot of time on media, but not necessarily on news media.
Yeah, I don't think, I think it's too early to say that trust has, grown in the people, in the public, for the media. I think the public continue to be cynical and critical of the media. But I think what's probably helping these numbers, the readership numbers, as case may be, particularly for newspapers, seems to be that there is greater curiosity about COVID-19 and all the measures around it. And in fact, 80% of the newspapers are about that, everything related to the current health emergency. So I think naturally it's a life or death situation, you know, in the minds of many people, and they want to get any scrap of news that they can. And they find that, I think it's fair for them to assume that newspapers, there's a fighting chance you get a more credible kind of information than searching it out in the social media. So in situations like this, it helps for the newspaper to bring it all together. That may be one of the reasons. But on the other hand, I'm wondering how it affects the economics of the newspaper. For instance, we know that beyond a point, every extra paper you print, if you don't get commensurate advertising, runs you deeper into the red. So I'm curious to know whether this spurt in readership is actually damning the newspapers, throwing them further down into an economic crisis, because there's no advertising from all that agency.
Okay, Shashi, you know, you have run the Asian College of Journalism through the Media Foundation for a long time, you know, considered to be one of India's better journalism schools.
It is, this because you teach there.
That's okay. That's full disclosure. Okay. But to ask you a very pointed question, you know, I mean, what do you think is going through the minds of young student journalists or students who are studying journalism as they look at this kind of bloodbath around them, jobs being lost, salaries being cut, you know, shutdowns, suspensions, this, that and the other, and also this overall shrinkage of media freedom. What is your advice to both student journalists and journalism teachers, you know, at this point? You know, what are the lessons we can draw from this current situation?
Yes, I think you're right. They feel very nervous. They feel very unsettled. They're very unsure about what is the real world of journalism they're going to step into, particularly those who are just passing out of a J school and moving into the world of journalism. And because this year the jobs haven't happened in the usual manner, because people are waiting for the lockdown to end in order to, you know, and there's no campus recruitment in the physical sense. So it's an online process which is dragging out. So things are a bit uncertain, and therefore that naturally affects them. But on the other hand, and this is what, and I believe this, I'm not saying this only to boost their morale. I think these young journalists from good J schools who are digitally equipped, who have the, you know, capacity to understand news, discerning eye for news, and the skill sets to handle news, whether it's in print or television or audio or podcast or video and so on. Those who are multi, you know, media skilled and digitally skilled will be in huge demand in the industry, because the industry is also using this time to shift more fully into the digital realm. I think the emphasis that I can see, the industry is heaving itself fully, or those who haven't yet got there in a big measure, into the digital realm. You know, there's a makeover that's taking place. So, and they need the practitioners, the people who can run that, who know that well, are these young people. So they have a huge future. Secondly, I think in the shakeout that's going to happen post COVID-19, I think the many journalists who are well paid, the higher paying jobs are likely to be substituted by lower paid jobs with more people perhaps, but who can handle that or approximate to that, those capacities, you know. So I think the younger people have, with these digital skill sets, I think will there's an opportunity in this current crisis for them, is how I look at it.
And how do teachers need to change, journalism teachers? Because I think, you know, whilst I keep hearing this point about students needing to be, or even working journalists needing to be more multi-skilled, you know, the fact that we are now going to spend more time at home and rehashing and repackaging and so on, where does that leave the whole teaching craft, where you teach the big, large ideas? You know, what happens to that for teachers? I mean, what should they be looking at? Should they be looking at just abandoning what they've done, or, you know, should they just kind of, you know, keep this also in mind? Or what is it? I mean, you know, really, journalism teaching is also going to be a bit of an issue from here on.
Yeah, I agree. It's going to be increasingly challenging to keep the cardinal principles and the core values, as we call them, of journalism in focus, because there is a lot of technology that's coming in between. There's a lot of the detail that may be, you know, taking over from the larger vision. But I think it's important to keep that in focus, keep that in the, you know, center stage. The need for the ethics of journalism, the raison d'etre of journalism. I think that this is the time to really be reflecting on that. In any college of journalism, I would spend the first few classes looking at purely why journalism, what is journalism for, why do we need journalism, what is it supposed to do, what is it supposed not to do, how is it acquitted itself. So this whole understanding of the media itself has become an important part, I think, a self-reflective part of journalism curriculum. At the ACJ, we do have a program called Media Perspectives, where we try and look at these aspects. And it's true that people with traditional skill sets will have to readjust in order to deliver these online, for instance, or deliver these in a more digital savvy world or context to younger minds. But that I find is not such a formidable task. We have formidable copy editors who are with the Hindu, for instance, for several years, and when they come and teach these young minds, they're actually adapting themselves very well. And but those skills are important. I think language will continue to be very important. Good clean copy, you know, because if you're on a digital platform, I think it's even more important, because it's more difficult for you to keep training your eyes on it, and therefore the language must actually attract you, must actually reach out and grab you. So I think the facility of expression, of crisp language, and so on and so forth, and apart from the production values and your metaphor, use of figures of speech, all of these are very important, and I think they will become even more consummate in handling this, because the technology enables them to do that. And I think even though I'm not myself, you know, in fact you, Krishna Prasad, are far more technology savvy than I am. It took me a while to figure out how to connect with you on Skype today. But, you know, but even so, I have an understanding that this is the future and this is the way it has to go.
No, and, you know, Shashi, you have, of course, the great honor of having set up India's first private news channel, Asianet News, back then. And you have also only recently set up Asia Will, which is a multimedia platform. What are you telling young journalists who are already working, or even middle-aged journalists who are already working, given what's in the future, what is it that you advise them?
Yeah, so what I try to tell them is, I try to say be heterodox, think out of the box, reimagine this whole thing called journalism. Don't be afraid of pushing the frontiers. Brinkmanship is your mantra. Do things which others are not doing, because unless you're a differentiator, you're going to be lost in the crowd. The clutter, it's such a big clutter out there that you need to actually set yourself apart as something different. So don't try to be another this channel or that newspaper or this portal. Try to be what you think is missing in all of that, or what you think can be beyond all of that, or what you think can be totally off from all of that. So I think that niche, as I said, there's no mass media out there. So we have to find our niches. And I also encourage young people at the ACJ, don't think of doing this course in order to find a job with A, B, C or D. You're doing this to acquire the skill sets and the capabilities and the confidence to be a media practitioner, a sovereign media practitioner yourself out there in this huge infinitesimal terra incognita called the internet space or cyberspace.
So I saved the toughest question for you, Shashi, for the very last. It's very easy to talk to you about journalism, about television and all that. And, the toughest question is also that you also acted in movies. And surely that is part of media, since we started talking about media. What do you think is happening in your movie world?
Oh, yeah. The movie world, I think, is going to find it very tough to cope with this, because, production challenges apart, how long will it take for people to have the trust to come back to theatres in a big manner, particularly multiplexes which charge higher, ticket rates and so on. So this, because it is a congregational medium, cinema as such. Of course, the movies can also be sold to OTT platforms like Netflix, Amazon and so on. And a lot of consumption is taking place there. So I don't think the industry itself will suffer too much. But, the idea of the superstar, for instance, I'm wondering, one of the thoughts that I've been, engaging with the last few days or last few weeks is, will superstardom be redefined because of COVID-19? Because unless you see this man in the huge screen in front of you in a darkened theater and, suspend disbelief and lay your sensibilities bare before the person, you will not inculcate, you will not imbibe the strength and the superhuman qualities of a superstar. Now, that is going to be, I don't know whether that's going to be affected. It's a ponderable. I'm wondering whether a new variety of stardom will emerge, in the celluloid space as a result of COVID-19 and the impact it's going to have on our mental process and the way it's going to transfigure us as movie buffs or movie, goers. Or cineas, as it's called.
Well, Shashi Kumar, you will always be a superstar on the Indian media firmament, regardless of whether there will be superstars. former foreign correspondent, former PTI TV founder of Asianet TV News, founder of Asian College of Journalism in Madras after it shifted from Bangalore. Actor, producer, writer, director, everything. Shashi, thank you so much for joining me on this episode of JPO.
That Krishna Prasad is characteristically but embarrassingly very generous of you. Thank you very much.
But that's also very journalistic. Thank you so much.
Thank you
very much.
Bye.